Should be talking to Von Shishaki. Now he's the one you want to talk to.
You know he won't talk to us, Arthur.
It was his process.
Tell me about that process. You used the powder?
We used the powder. The girls mixed it with an adhesive to make the paint. But that business with the brushes, I didn't invent that. They were doing that when I started.
But you knew about it.
We all knew about it. We just didn't realize what it meant.
Irene? In here!
Irene, what are you doing? Shut the door!
Amelia's working inspection today.
Is that bad?
Not for us. She's gonna be in here all day, in the dark, checking dials.
So we're gonna give her a little surprise.
Boo! With the Cheshire cat.
Won't that make her mad?
Let her get mad.
That's half the fun.
I don't wanna make her mad.
Oh, Grace, you have to be that way about everything?
What way? Here, put some on your teeth.
Ain't like Amelia don't deserve it. She makes more dolls than any girl on the floor. Can't be bothered to talk to nobody either. You say, Amelia, what's new? She just looks at you funny.
I don't think she can speak much English.
It wouldn't kill her to smile, would it?
They're coming!
Get the light! Oops.
Mrs. McNeil! Painting your faces. How you gone off your minds?
It was just a joke.
Just a joke? A joke like that could lose a girl her job.
No, no, Miss McNeil. I'm sure that's not necessary.
I don't tolerate foolishness, Doctor.
Yeah, really good. Foolishness we don't want, do we? Miss Delita, this is the inspection room. All the dials come here to get painted. And here are some girls who should be on the floor working. Girls, this is Mr. Lita, our new vice president, and your new plant manager.
And I was just telling him what a fine bunch of girls we have here. I'm sure he must think I'm halfway out of my mind.
Mr. Lita, perhaps you have some words for the girls. Mrs. McNeil.
Well, girls, the paint you've been playing with is very expensive. You realize this?
Yes, sir.
It takes several tons of ore to produce a single gram of radium. That's a lot of work. Hard work for the men in the extraction plant. But they do this work gladly. Do you understand why? Why they work so hard? What we're all working for?
The war?
That's right, the war. The dials you paint save lives, girls. Our boys in the field depend on them. Breathe them in the dark, no mistaking what they've seen. Otherwise, some of our boys won't be returning home. So, girls, if you play around and don't take your work seriously, well, you're playing into the hands of Kaiser! And we don't want that. Now, do we?
No, sir, not at all.
Very well, let's get back to work and leave the tomfoolery to home.
Mr. Reader, I just wanted to say, I'm sorry, I won't ever do anything like that again.
Well, dear, just keep this in mind. If you do right by us, we'll do right by you.
March 21st, 1921. Nancy Jane Harmon here for the New York Graphic. The New York Graphic's only girl reporter.
Jackie Youngwood for the New York Ledger. New York's first source for news.
Madame Marie Curie, eminent French scientist, embarked on a whistle stop tour of the United States.
First stop, New York City, where she is greeted by an enthusiastic crowd of well-wishers.
Pretense of science is heading to Washington, D.C. to receive a gift of 1 gram of radium valued at $100,000.
Purchased donation of 100,000 American women
who each gave $1 to support a humanitarian research with radium.
Grace, over here!
Irene! Look, member Mary Curie Radium Club.
You paid a dollar?
It's all for science.
Science, look at my room and board.
Look, there she is!
Welcome all, welcome all. I would like to ask you, ladies and gentlemen of the press, please limit your questions. Dr. Curie is on a very tight schedule, and she has to embark on an exhaustive tour of the country. She will get the gift of 1 gram of radium after meeting with the president.
Yes, ma'am.
And you're not
not to get new brushes until you've done with the old ones, and they've got to be so bad they can't even hold a point.
You can't make quota like that.
Well, you'll do your best then, since I've received my instructions.
I need a new brush.
It's not for us to be asking questions, is it? It's for us to do the work.
I have my instructions, girls. I have my instructions.
Here's an instruction for you, Emil. Let's put the starch out of your corset.
Was she at the service?
You kidding? McNeil went across the street for her own mother.
Most everyone else was, though. You was about the only girl from the floor not there.
I wanted to go, but Ma was working and I had to watch the little ones.
You could have brought them.
All seven?
Well, if it was me, I'd try to get there.
Just lay off. Please feel as bad as it is.
Were many of the fellas there?
Sure, plenty of the fellas from downstairs. Roth from the office, Dr. Von Shishaki, even Mr. Reeder.
And he left early.
So, he was there all the same. Oh, and that fellow from Crystallizing, what's his name? The fellow with the red hair.
Oh, the tall fellow with the freckles?
Yeah, that's the one who snaps his fingers all the time.
George.
Jerry.
I think it was George.
It's Jerry, Jerry Mullen. He was the one who was talking to Amelia in the day room.
Oh, that's right, Grace. You should have seen it. When the service was over, he goes over to the casket and like this, he goes.
No.
Yes.
Really?
Really?
Oh, for God's sakes.
Well, he did. No one could believe it.
So what if he did?
So what? He was in love with her. That's so what? Don't you think so, Grace?
Well, I guess he had to be. He did that.
And can you imagine? Can you imagine? If he was in love with her and he never told her because she was so beautiful and he was so shy. But he didn't tell her. He didn't tell her. Their love is forever thwarted and he'll never get a chance again.
Poor Amelia.
Poor Amelia.
Poor kid.
Her family took it awful bad, Grace. Albina, Quinta, every one of them crying. Even her father, crying like a baby. I had never seen a man like that, just bawling.
And you know why, too.
Because their daughter had died.
Well, she had died from.
Irene, don't go spreading stories.
It's not a story. Albina told us. No reason Grace shouldn't know.
Know what? Know what? Amelia?
Ain't it awful? Albina said her father's fit to be tied, too. Six girls and ain't none of them ever going to a dance again.
Oh, because Amelia Upton died from syphilis.
Shh!
Ain't my fault that's what she died from.
You don't know that for sure.
It was on the death certificate.
Anemia and complications from syphilis.
But Amelia was ever so nice.
Guess she got around more than we knew.
Maybe it's a mistake. Maybe the doctor got it wrong.
Oh, come on.
He could have got it wrong. Doctors are wrong sometimes.
That's true. Doctor was wrong about Aunt Ivy.
What's Mama got to do with it?
Irene, don't you remember? Doctor said Aunt Ivy would be fine. Have a cup of tea, get a good night's rest, and she'd be better by morning. And 3 days later, we were taking her to Rosedale Cemetery.
Girls, girls, your attention, please. The men are here to make an announcement.
Thank you, Miss Neal. Girls, we are here to put a few rumors to rest.
And to explain some changes, y'all.
Yes, as some of you girls may have heard by now, Dr. Von Shishaki is stepping down from his position, and he wanted to take this opportunity
to make with goodbye. And Mr. Leo has kindly consented. Some of you I've known since you were little girls, coming here during the war, working so hard, day after day as a bench. 200, 300, some of you $500 a day. So excited to be part of your work here. When this company I started in my own kitchen, mixing up some paint, I knew I found something miraculous to make life better, easier. And now what do I read? More and more uses are there for the radium, more than our dreams possible.
Thank you, Doctor.
Yes, thank you, Doctor. Now, girls, the doctor is a busy man and must be on his way. So let's wish him the best of luck on his new business ventures. Very good, then, girls.
And Miss Alita, best good luck wish you also. Girls, as of today, he steps as your new company president.
Our congratulations to you.
Thank you.
When Mr. Lita came to us 4 years ago, I saw in him a young man with great enterprise.
Thank you.
And great ambition.
Yes, thank you.
Little did I guess how far that ambition would take, but one of the things that makes this country great is the opportunity presents to a young man in this fund.
And so, girls,
let us wish Mr. Lita the very best in the new direction he intends the company to take.
New direction?
With the slowdown in dial painting.
No, doctor.
As a business moving into the medical market, there's going to be lots of changes, young.
What the doctor is referring to, some of our larger customers are setting up their own dial painting studios.
Which means less work for our girls here.
In the short run, things may be slower here. However, the Waterbury Clock Company in Connecticut will need help setting up their new studio. We are intending to make an announcement next week. We'll make it now, Mrs. Neal.
Down there.
The work is supervisory in nature, which means more pay. Did you have any girls in mind?
Yes. Louise Collins, Sarah Deutsch, Lena McCarthy, Catherine Schwab. I'll post the entire list later on today.
Fine. There you have it, girls. As we are all on the clock, we'll leave you to your work.
Thank you, ladies. My very best wishes to you.
And that's back to work for you girls.
Are you gonna do it, Catherine? Are you gonna take that job?
Would you, Grace? Would you go to Connecticut?
Oh, I don't know. That's awful far from home. Tell me you have a fit.
Oh, come on. It would be so much fun. Right, Irene?
Irene, honey, you all right?
Yeah. Huh? Why wouldn't I be all right?
Your mouth is bleeding.
What?
$35
a week and she quits the place.
What a life
of
money.
That's what you say when you're young, Tom, but you get to be my age with a house and the kids on your foot. You'll thank God for every penny you put by.
We got money put by.
How much?
Enough to get married on.
Don't take much to get married on. Do you have enough to stay married on?
Well, if you let us get married, we'll find out.
Tommy, are you still eating?
Yeah, it's good.
You're going to get fat.
Gotta keep up his strength. He works hard for his money.
Don't start, Mom.
I didn't say anything. It was your father who hit the roof over it.
He didn't hit the roof.
Oh, you should have seen his face, Tom. When he heard Grace had quit the place, most girls would have given their eye teeth for a job like that. Easy money, good work, lots of cute fellas around the plant.
You didn't tell me about them, Grace.
There wasn't that many of them. Hardly seemed worth a mention.
And she leaves it all behind for reasons unknown. I'm tired of it up there, she says. Are you tired of the paycheck, I says? Who needs a paycheck, she says. I got to meet a fiancé to take me out Saturdays.
She said that?
Oh, you know I didn't. And besides, I got a job. I start at the bank on Monday.
Oh yeah, the bank, and what's that pay?
Enough.
Enough? Always enough. You know what that means, Tom? That means it'll pay anywhere near what it pays up at the Radium plant.
It's office work.
Office work? I guess that means you'll be spending more money on clothes then.
Boy, she's really steamed at you.
I don't see what difference it makes, so long as I'm working somewheres.
Don't make no difference to me. I just thought you liked it up there.
Sure I liked it up there. I worked there 4 years.
Well, so? I've been delivering mail for almost 8 years. I plan to keep on delivering mail another 20 or 30 years, if I'm lucky. Nothing like steady work and a good pension to help you sleep at night.
I don't have a pension, and I sleep just fine.
I bet you do. So, how come you quit, Grace?
Lots of girls are quitting. Work is slow. Besides, since Irene left, it's just not as much fun anymore. And wouldn't you rather have a fiancé that works at a bank?
Not as much as I'd like to have a wife that don't work anywhere.
Close your eyes. I got a surprise for you.
Yeah? Want me to pull the shades?
Not that kind of surprise. Close your eyes. Now open.
Wallpaper.
For the baby's room.
For the baby's room? You won't kiss me. You're talking about babies?
There's gonna be babies eventually, Tommy.
Yeah, sure. But you know, Grace, most girls, they get married before they decorate the nursery.
Plan ahead for once. Pick one.
They're both the same.
No, they're not. This one has big flowers, and this one has little flowers. So pick one.
Is this some kind of test?
No, it's just wallpaper.
This is some kind of test.
Pick one, Tommy.
That one.
Really?
Oh, the other one, then.
Which one do you like, though?
They're both nice.
This one's nice, don't you think?
Yeah, that one then.
But I want you to like it too.
If you like it, I'll like it. Wallpaper's wallpaper.
No, it isn't. You gotta pick something you can stand to look at for the next 20 years.
Same way you pick woman?
Keep it up, smarty pants. You'll never get that kiss.
Okay. This one. This one hands down.
I like it too. A nice neutral yellow goes with either boy or girl. And until the baby comes, we can use them for other things.
Yeah? Like what?
Like a painting studio, maybe?
Painting studio, maybe. Didn't you get enough of painting at work?
Not the kind I wanted to do, Tommy. I used to paint watercolors at school, and ever since I left, I just don't have no time. What with helping Ma and watching the kids. Once we get married, I just want some time. Just some time to myself, so as I can paint watercolors or oils. Maybe portraits in oil. I could paint your picture if you like.
Why not? Paint a big picture of me while hanging in the outhouse. All our friends will come around just to use the can so they can look at it.
Oh, the way you talk sometimes.
Aw, Grace, you want to paint pictures? Paint pictures. I ain't gonna stop you.
You say that now, Tommy, but once we're married, you'll change your tune.
Sure, I'll be whistling Dixie.
Wait till you come home some night. All worn out. Some Christmas maybe, when every customer on your route had 3 times the mail. And some doctor got to you. And some old lady kept you on her porch, telling you all about her grandchildren. And you wouldn't have the heart to tell her you can't talk. I know you. So you come home all cranky and late, besides, hungry, wanting your dinner. And there I am, with my easel set up in the kitchen, a drop cloth on the floor, and my paints all over the table. And your dinner, nowhere in sight. What would you say then?
Better be a picture of me you're painting.
I know what you'd say. Where's my dinner? That's what you'd say. Where's my dinner?
Well, sure, but I'd still admire the painting. I just want to look at it on a full stomach is all. So, how'd I do? Pick the right wallpaper.
I don't know. Maybe I'll go look at stripes.
Stripes? Polka dots? I don't care, Grace. Let's just get married. You're plenty old enough. Tell your mom we ain't waiting no more. We can just run off.
Tommy! We are not running off. We're gonna do it right. A nice white wedding with flowers and music, and then a week on the seashore. Just us. You'll see. It'll be worth the wait.
Your mouth hurt ya?
Yeah, the dentist wants to pull another tooth in the back.
Well, what's a tooth?
Hazel Huser. Any connection to the other? Only by virtue of employment, except she's got a good lawyer.
Don't just want to write a good letter anyway, that lawyer.
And she no longer works here?
Left 6 months ago.
This makes 4 now.
Three.
4 if you count my guy, girl.
I wouldn't include her.
She worked here.
She also worked other places. But what she died from, you couldn't pick up here. At least I don't think you can.
But that's not funny, Charlie. Besides, that's just idle talk.
Well, in my experience, there's usually something to that idle talk. When it comes to girls like that.
From a large family, wasn't she?
Italians. The conditions they lived in. 10, 12 people in 3 rooms. It's a wonder they don't all die of one infection or another.
3 then, and how many then?
Only Miss Magaya, but I haven't heard from her people.
It's too late for her anyways. The statute of limitations is 2 years, and Miss Huser's another story. She's in a position to make some trouble now.
All the time I've been here, no one has so much as slipped on the floor, and now this!
We're talking about 4 girls out of how many hundreds that we've employed?
600, 700 over the years.
And some of them were sick when they got here. One girl, you hired, was a complete cripple. Couldn't even climb up the stairs. Her father had to carry her up to the studio every morning.
Didn't make any difference to me how she got up those stairs. She was a fast worker and a very sweet little girl.
But she was in poor health.
She needed the work.
Charlie.
And not just for the money. To feel productive. To have a purpose. That's what work does for us, Charlie. It gives us a purpose. I don't see any reason why you should stop hiring girls like that.
When they get sick and trying to blame us for it, you, my friend, might want to reconsider that policy.
Let's just see what Dr. Drinker has to say.
Dr. Drinker?
Some professor at a Harvard School of Industrial Hygiene.
He chairs the department, and he's agreed to take a look at our operation.
Don't you think we're jumping the gun a bit? Hiring him?
We've had 6 girls quit this week, and Miss McNeil tells me there could be more.
All girls come and go all the time.
It's never been like this. These girls are terrified. We've got to do something to calm them.
Letting Drinker examine them? That sounds to me like a recipe for mass hysteria.
Well, tell them it's a routine physical. Edward,
companies give routine physicals all the time.
Then Drinker will start next month.
In the meantime, I recommend we make an offer to Miss Huser.
Settle?
But there's no proof her problems are connected to us.
If she sues, believe me, you won't like the publicity it brings, and neither will your investors.
You think this will affect the stock offering?
Don't you?
Wonderful. We'll open at 30 and close at 10.
We're not open at all.
But if we give this girl something, that'll keep her quiet?
It would be a condition of the settlement.
Maybe we better do it.
Suppose that lawyer has a racket going. He finds sick girls and talks them into making suits. Then we reward him for his larceny.
Unless Miss Cousy generally believes she got sick here.
It could be like Charlie said, from a large immigrant family. Not well educated, not a lot of resources.
A few hundred dollars can make a big difference to a girl like that.
Certainly. Pay a few doctor's bills, buy some medicine. From the looks of that letter, I don't think she has long to live anyway.
So, it would be a gesture of decency then?
Exactly.
How much do you think we should offer?
March 24th, 1924. Jackie Youngwood for the New
York Ledger. Nancy Dane Hyman here for the Graphic.
Could radium wire pose a cure for crippling arthritis? Scientific studies suggest a connection.
Dateline, Orange, New Jersey. Could radium water bottle offer a miracle cure for crippling arthritis?
Some patients report a significant abatement in their symptoms.
Mr. Jeremy Michael of the Bronx tells how radium water transformed her life.
My pain was so bad I could hardly bend over.
Well, others reported only mild relief.
This poor, brave woman could not even bend down to kiss her little ones goodnight.
And I got three of them. Let me tell you, they're a handful.
Dr. Harriet Martland, chief medical examiner for East Sussex Country, commented on the study.
Preliminary at best.
Your recommendations, Dr. Martland?
I advise further study, further study.
That Mrs. Michael tried bad for.
They said it would help with my rheumatism, so I took a bottle a day for a month. It wasn't cheap, but I was desperate.
Dr. William J. A. Bailey of Orange, chief medical examiner for Radium Board, reports strong demand for his products.
Dr. William Bailey of Orange announces sales of Radium exceed 100,000 cases worldwide.
Radioactivity is one of the most remarkable ages of medical science. I drink Radium myself, and I can vouch for its power.
Just a bottle a day?
At $1 a bottle?
Worth every penny?
Yes, indeed. I myself was the picture of larceny before discovered the amazing, vitalizing qualities of radium water. Now look at me. I'm nearly 50 years old, but I have the energy of a man in his 30s.
You gotta look at man in his 30s.
Well, thanks.
I tested the tonic potency.
Or is the seller's creativity?
Radithor, it's perpetual sunshine.
An impressionable money machine for its inventor.
Is there no end to what science can do?
Maybe we should have made an appointment.
Don't need no appointment.
But it's a busy place, Catherine. If you don't have an appointment, maybe you should make one.
I shouldn't need no appointment for this.
I'm so sorry. I don't want anything under Shaw.
No, it's under Rudolph.
Rudolph?
That's the girl I'm asking about, Irene Rudolph?
Did she file a complaint?
No, her dentist did.
Her dentist?
Dr. Neff, Irene's dentist. He said she might have phossy jaw, and so he filed a complaint to the health department. But when I asked him, he said he hadn't heard nothing, and it's been 6 months now.
Phossy jaw, is it?
Yes!
Catherine, it could have been like your doctor said, a blood infection.
Yeah, but that's the thing. What gave it to her?
From dirt? You get infections from dirt.
From dirt? Her face puffed up like a pumpkin. Her jaw rotted so bad she couldn't eat nothing. You get something like that from a little dirt? You get it from phosphorus. You're telling everyone it's radium in that paint, but it's phosphorus that makes it glow.
You can't really believe that. You saw her.
Catherine, if it was like you'd say, they never let you work up there in the first place.
Sure, they had to shut the place down.
Oh, really? Who? Who would have shut the place down?
I don't know, the county?
Honestly, Grace, you are such a ninny.
Hey.
How are they gonna shut it down if they don't know about it? Did you ever think of that?
Now, come on.
It's all right, Tony.
She got no business talking to you that way.
She's just upset.
Upset? She's got her on the bend. She probably thinks they're dumping arsenic in the drinking water now. Next, it'll be the kidnapping babies and using them to stoke the furnace.
You go ahead and laugh. You won't be laughing so hard when you're in here 6 months from now asking after Grace.
Oh, for crying out loud.
Catherine, it's just a toothache.
Just a toothache? That's how it started for Irene. Just a toothache. You wait, Grace, you wait. One morning, you're gonna wake up with your gums hurting so bad you won't be able to open your mouth. So weak and sick, you won't be able to stand up.
Stop it, Catherine.
The pain's so bad you won't be able to sleep, and your face so swollen you won't be able to stand the sight of yourself.
I said stop it. fine. Right, Gracie?
Irene Rudolph? Yes, that's her. She worked at the radium plant?
Yes.
Nothing.
What?
The company is in full compliance with all state health and labor regulations.
Let me say that.
Miss, really?
Who's Miss Young?
It's a health officer. Miss
Paint is a harmless compound of radium and zinc.
As I was saying, the analysis shows that there's no phosphorus in the paint. There's no phosphorus anywhere in the plant.
You see, Catherine?
Miss Young turned the plant herself. She found nothing amiss. I'm sorry.
Well, guess we can get some lunch then.
I want to file another complaint.
They already did an investigation.
I want to file another complaint.
Oh, brother.
Catherine, it's a busy place. I want to file another complaint.
I just don't see what good this is going to do, Catherine, to make such a fuss this way.
Grace, 3 surgeries, and they wanted to cut her again. She finally said no. What was left of her jaw had rotted so bad, the smell was horrible. I couldn't look at her. And the worst part of it was that she was so scared of being alone. And when she died, it was the middle of the night, and no one was with her.
Excuse me. My friend would like to file another complaint.
Another complaint? Is the girl still sick?
No, she died.
Wait right here.
Because she no longer wants to climb trees.
What's this?
Something to give you vitality.
You think I need vitality?
That's what it says in the bottle.
Is it Pierre?
We're his supplier. Did you want to try it?
Well, if it'll give me vitality, suppose I couldn't refuse. Your father came by to see me today.
Another hard luck case.
Throw a child at home, all under the age of 6.
Wife in the hospital with cancer.
Yes.
And the husband's been laid off from, let's see here, the brickyard.
Yes.
Though no fault of his own.
How did you know?
Dad was around to see me yesterday. It's never enough of him. Just have ordinary ambitions. You need to have a mission in life.
And you do?
No. I have a business plan.
You can't tell me you wouldn't help this man if you could.
If I could, but I can't give him a job that just doesn't exist.
What about Dan Lemon?
Dan?
Couldn't he use some help?
In the laboratory? No. Dan needs trained technicians, not a bricklayer. Why don't you send him to Miss Middleton? Don't you women have a social club, things like this?
You mean the Women's Club Civics Committee?
Right.
Well, we do take interest in such cases, but we're not in employment service either, which is why I thought you could help him.
Oh, you do love being married to the company president.
It has its advantages.
Everything is going to get in.
Do you?
I got my shoes shined this morning, and while I sat there and watched the boy work, I thought, this is quite an enterprise. The work walks in, the work walks out. No inventory, no warehouse, no health inspectors, no stock price.
You'll trade it all in for your own shoe shine stand.
Fewer headaches that way.
So you're in one of those moods again. What is it this time? It can't be the market. What up today?
Now you're reading the financial pages?
Have to entertain myself somehow. So, what is it? You're acting very strange.
Am I? I'm sorry.
You can tell me, you know.
Nothing to tell. This is going to be our best year ever.
So it's the prospect of success you find so disheartening.
I'll get my checkbook.
What for?
Your bricklayer.
Artie, he's a job, not charity. You know what your father used to say. A working man needs to work. It wears
on his soul not to work. But if it's a matter of his soul, that's different. All right, I'll have a talk with them.
Artie.
But I make no promises, Diane.
No promises.
To your health.
How long have you had this ridge?
A week or two. Heard something awful, Dr. Neff.
Anything else bothering you?
Back hurts some too.
You're back now. Have you seen your regular doctor?
He says it's nerves.
Nerves?
About my wedding and all.
This ain't no case of nerves. I hope we told him that.
What do you think?
I think you better schedule that surgery.
Couldn't we put it off at least until after the wedding?
You wouldn't have that surgery. You wouldn't have no wedding.
Huh?
Miss Fryer, I want you to listen to me. Your jawbone is the cave. That's the black pus oozing out of your gums. It's the bone itself.
That's impossible!
Ah, to Mr. Arthur Reeder, U.S. Radium Corporation. Frost is still drinker, Harvard University, and closes our report.
Finally!
We believe the trouble in your plant is due to the radium.
Radium?
It can't be as bad as all that.
This can't be.
Put off the surgery and you will develop a septic condition. It could be fatal.
The blood changes in your employees can be explained on no other grounds.
Everything I've got, I saved for my wedding.
The photographic film carried by the employees show heavy fogging.
Well, I got a suggestion for you.
And we suspect high levels of gamma radiation throughout the plant.
Go to the radium plant and explain your situation. Go to the company.
We realize no proof can be offered here at present.
Once they see what kind of shape we're in.
This is impossible.
They got the law again to help you out.
But in the view and the material and the literature...
It's a mistake!
And the facts disclosed by our investigation...
I don't see how they could refuse.
We recommend immediate and drastic re-medical attention.
Look, if you want, I can write something for you. They get more through me, just pay me both directly. Do you think they'd do that?
Charlie!
You got a moral obligation, don't you think?
I guess so.
We can get started right now. I'll give you some paper.
No. This can't be. He has to be wrong. That's all. He's wrong. Charlie, he has to be wrong.
Yeah. Must have overlooked something.
If we're suffering from a new ailment caused by the radium, shouldn't it occur generally throughout the plant?
One would expect.
There are several hundred of milligrams are in the solution. At all times, the big vats. Several hundred milligrams are in the ore. Several hundred in crystallizing.
The entire backyard is filled with tailings.
Radium is present in good amounts all over the property.
Well, if it's the radium, then the incidence of illness should be the highest in the laboratory.
But no one there is sick.
Then perhaps it's some combination of the radium with the zinc.
Or something peculiar to our plant alone.
Some kind of bacteria, perhaps? In the brushes?
It can't be the radium. There are dozens of application plants all across the country, and none have ever reported anything like this.
The Department of Labor wants to see that report.
I know.
Well, then what are we going to do? This tears us to pieces. How do we answer them?
They want to see the report? We'll send them this page.
One page?
The most important page.
Drinker will never stand for this.
Drinker works for us. He has a proprietary duty to the company. What we do with this is our business.
But the Department of Labor, Arthur.
We just need time, Charlie. Just a little time.
They can shut us down for this.
Scientists, government men, they have no idea what it takes to run a business. Von Tschokke thought advertising was a dirty word. He laughed at the very idea of promotion. I cannot tell you how many times I walked into that man's office and he turned a deaf ear to everything I told him. But look at us. We're now the largest single supplier of radium, the largest in the world. Do you know what it took for us to get here? Do you think I'm going to stand idly by and let a good name be dragged through the mud? Trust me, Charlie.
Dr. Flynn, it's awful nice of you to come all this way.
Not at all, my dear, not at all.
I told my surgeon you were coming to see me, so he gave me the results of my blood work.
Excellent.
And so?
I must say, Miss Fire, your blood looks better than mine.
It does?
That's what happens to an old woman who smokes. Now, tell me, what else is troubling you?
My back and feet, mostly. I've had to wear a brace for a while.
I see. And this started before you left the company, or after?
After I left. Dr. Neff said that it all has to do with the radium plant. Another girl I worked with died from it. Irene Rudolph.
Oh, yes. Terrible thing.
Benton angina.
What's that?
That's an ulcerated condition of the mouth, my dear.
From the radium?
Oh, no, 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 no! That is a rare and unfortunate result of poor dental care. Let this be a lesson to you. Always brush your teeth.
There was something else in the paper about this. About other girls who got sick. This one girl who I worked with for a while, she's in the hospital in New York, and the doctors don't know what to do.
Miss Fire, don't tell me you pay any attention to the story. Those papers are not scientific.
But
reporters are not scientific, Miss Fire. They do not follow the scientific method. They write to sell, not to educate. The scientist is not concerned with what sells. She is concerned with the truth. She undertakes years of painstaking research to arrive at an understanding of intricate natural proportions that most people could never even presume to comprehend. You would do well to ignore it printed in the newspapers and to listen to science, because I can tell you radium has nothing to do with what's ailing you.
It doesn't?
Not in the least.
Then what is ailing me?
Poor diet, Miss Fryer. Poor diet.
But Dr. Neff said...
Dr. Neff is a dentist, not a physician. What you have is a vitamin deficiency. You must eat more fresh fruit.
Hard to do in the winter.
And raw meat as well. That will help with the anemia, particularly raw calf liver. Cook it if you must, but eat it twice a week at a minimum. Oh, no, 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 Miss Fire, I am a scientist, and I take a purely scientific interest in your case by allowing me to examine you. You're allowing me to further advance my research, and I thank you. Call me any time, day or night.
All right, Dr. Flynn, thank you.
Happy to be of service, my dear.
Dr. Francine Flynn, PhD, Physiology, Columbia University. PhD? That's not a real doctor.
My finding, Mr. Reader. She's seen half a dozen girls who's worked at the factory. Last I heard, she's working for the company.
An objective evaluation, I trust.
The source of my funding has no bearing on my research.
And I let that lady examine me.
I never examined her, per se. It was not a medical examination, per se.
Nevertheless, you were able to offer her some useful advice.
I did my best for her.
Nothing wrong with you, she says.
Your blood is better than mine, she says.
And how are you coming along on the rest of the report?
The animal studies I conducted revealed no adverse effects from the radium. The problem is, as you suspected, one of personal hygiene only.
I can't believe someone would do that. Straight out lie to you like that.
Nothing surprises me anymore.
It's just like you said, Catherine. These people will say anything, they'll do anything.
Except for the right thing.
But we're gonna make them, Catherine. We're gonna make sure someone hears about this.
I'm most grateful, Dr. Flynn. But I'm most grateful to hear that the young girl you examined is doing much better.
Didn't examine her, no. I merely consulted with her.
All the same, she's doing much better, isn't that so?
From what I can see, Mr. Meter, she appears to be on the road to recovery.
Excellent.
Here is a copy of my fees and expenses.
Mr. Liebel, draw you a check.
And so I leave you all now with this one thought. Ladies and gentlemen, we do not need to accept injustice. We can use our powers as consumers to influence those who wish to profit from our patronage. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Wiley, and thank you to the New Jersey Consumers League for another job well done. That concludes our program for this evening. I don't believe we have time for any questions, but I hope you'll join us next door for some light refreshments.
It's all right, Miss Middleton. It's fine.
You must be Miss Fryer.
Yes, Miss Young, the health department said I should see you. I know I should have stopped by your office, but I've missed so much work lately and I didn't want to miss no more.
No need to apologize. I was mean to call upon you. Please, take a seat.
Me and Kathy, we wrote to the company about our troubles, but we never heard anything.
Then we went to see a couple of lawyers, but they all said they can't do anything because it's been so long since we left the company. Something about the law won't allow it.
The statute of limitations.
Right. And one lawyer said he'd try to sue anyhow. Only he wants $1,000 up front. I already spent everything I saved for my wedding on dentists and doctors and hospitals, and I still don't know what's wrong exactly. And Tom, that's my fella, he says he don't care. He wants to get married anyhow. But I just wonder, what good would I do in my business, Wiley? If I could just get some of my compensation, I could settle my debts, and then I wouldn't have to worry about Sally and Tom with such a burden. I'm sorry to rattle on you about these things. I'm just so tired of being pushed around.
I don't blame you.
Miss Young at the health department. She said the Consumers League has, what was it, clout?
I'd like to think so. We have had our share of successes lately.
Can you help us then?
Tell me, Miss Fryer, just how far are you willing to go with this?
Ma'am?
Suppose I do find a lawyer to take your case. Someone that'll take it on a contingency. You won't have to pay unless you want. Would you be willing to sue?
I want my compensation.
Of course. So suppose the company goes, here's some money for you, Miss Fryer. Only you are to say nothing about what happened to you. You are to say nothing about how you got sick.
Keep it quiet, you mean?
Yes.
That don't seem right.
No, it isn't right, but that's what they'll do. They'll try to buy your silence. Is it for sale, Miss Fryer?
No, ma'am, it isn't.
Good.
Can you help us then?
I think I can help you, if you're willing to take some chances.
Chances?
Miss Fryer, if you can put aside your own needs just for a moment, we can put an end to this company. We can stop them right in their tracks.
What do I have to do?
We start by putting you on page one.
Page one? You want me to talk to the newspaper?
Not just one newspaper. Many, many newspapers.
Is that really necessary? All we want is Grace to get her compensation.
Tommy, let her finish.
I understand your concerns, but the company has shown it's willing to go to the extremes to protect itself. No, I'm afraid the only way we'll get to them is to hit them where it matters most. Their public image. When every newspaper in America reads about how you suffered, how you were sorely treated, and how the company denied all responsibility, believe me, Miss Fryer, when that gets out, Arthur Reader will come to the table with his hat in his hands.
All right, Miss Wiley.
I understand it can be a bit frightening.
It's okay. Right now, I'm more angry than I'm scared.
Good. You hold on to that anger, Miss Fryer. You're going to need it. Only make sure no one else sees it.
Ma'am?
Public sympathy, Miss Fryer. It's our greatest weapon. And the public does not have much sympathy for an angry woman.
$250,000.
Ask me, it's all a sham.
But what do you mean? Those girls are very sick.
Sick of working, sure.
Doctors say the Radium girls have only a year to live.
Only a year to live and 250 grand to spend? What would you do with that kind of money?
What would you do to ease your last suffering days on Earth? What would you do with $250,000?
I'd buy a wardrobe, black and green castles.
I'd give it all to charity.
In our car, I'm going first class with one more friend.
I'd play the stock market.
I'd buy my wife a fur coat and a diamond the size of New Hampshire.
I'd use it to pay my medical bills. And pay off the second mortgage on our house, the one my father used to pay for my last operation.
Oh my gosh.
Pretty young Grace Fryer sits at home.
Suffering bravely for this entire ordeal.
Struggling valiantly to keep up her flagrant spirits.
For the sake of her family and her friends.
It hurts to smile, but I try to smile. I know if I don't smile, I'll go crazy.
You go.
Tell us, Miss Fryer, how does it feel knowing you have so little time left?
I try not to think about it.
But it must get to you sometimes.
Know what you've been through?
And the company's getting fat off your labor.
And all they have to say about it is,
no comment!
Don't you just want to punch somebody?
Oh no, that won't do no good.
I'd rather just think about
how it's gonna be when justice prevails. Then I can do something nice for the folks. Maybe send them on vacation. They never did have no honeymoon.
What a fine example of womanhood. We can all only aspire to bear our past in life as nobly as this woman.
Miss Berry, I must object to this kind of history.
I have nothing to do with that, Mr. Barkley.
I've been in this game a long time, Miss Berry. When I see a story like this move over the wires, I'm not so naive as to believe a plaintiff's attorney has nothing to do with it.
What's your proposal, Mr. Barkley?
$1,500 for each girl.
$1,500?
That's not even a year's wages!
We think it's very generous considering your case will last a statute of limitations.
This is a case in equity, sir. The Chancery Court will come to a different conclusion.
The Chancery Court can rewrite the law, and the law is clear. 2 years from the day of injury, your clients are out of time.
2 years from the date the cause of injury is discovered.
Very creative, Miss Berry. Very clever. I have to admire your imagination, but you have a long way to go before you convince the judge.
And in the meantime, Mr. Markley, the press will continue to take great interest in the story, and the company is complete indifference to its workers!
No doubt that will prove to be good press for the Consumers League, and you accuse us of exploiting these girls.
You're the one hiding behind the statute of limitations.
Hiding, Miss Wiley?
You know very well the law never anticipated for a situation like this. These girls were dying years before anyone knew the cause.
Before anyone knew, does that include the U.S. Radium Corporation, Miss Wiley? If, or I should say when, this case goes to trial, I hope that's your only opening statement. See you at the hearing.
Arrogance of that man!
Tell me again the purposes of the articles, Miss Wiley.
Public sympathy, Miss Berry. It's the engine of reform.
You're antagonizing the company.
And the strategy is working.
Well, what about the girls? How does it help them to read a dozen different newspapers that they have so little time to live?
Miss Berry, surely you can see. The U.S. Radium Corporation cares nothing about the girls they poison. But the average housewife of Warren sure does, and so do millions of other women across the country. These women shop, they buy watches. This remark that can be as smug as he wants, but the Consumer League campaign will lead to only one outcome. And he knows it, and that's why he's here today.
I only hope you're right, Miss Wiley.
Public sympathy, Miss Berry. Wait and see.
Dear Miss Schwab, I read of your sad story, Boston Globe, and I'm so sorry for your plight. It seems in this time of rapid advancement, the well-being of the average worker is overlooked. I would like to share with you girls the key to my own good health at the age of 92. It's called Christian Science.
Dear Miss Fryer, I read of your woeful situation in the Atlanta Constitution, and I prepared to offer you a solution, venison, a wonder tonic made from all natural ingredients. Venison will restore your health and vitality. We prepared to offer you girls a lifetime supply of venison in exchange for your exclusive rights in our pictures, in our advertisements.
Dear girl, I read about you in the Jones Gazette. I run 100 head of cattle up here, and I do very well by myself. I've always longed for a companion, and I'm well equipped to offer you a comfortable home in your final hours. A girl like you suffered so much. Don't you think you deserve a few fleeting hours of happiness? Sincerely, your admirer, Leonard F. Watkins. P.S. and close to my picture.
Look at this, Catherine. This man actually sent a picture. You all right, Catherine?
Bleeding again.
Shall I get the nurse?
No, don't. It did this before. It'll stop.
Maybe we should go.
No, please don't go.
Don't you need to sleep?
Who can sleep? I never sleep.
Well, you'll sleep tomorrow.
Yeah, I might not wake up.
Of course you'll wake up.
Not if it don't go so well. Sometimes they don't. My mother's cousin went to the hospital for her appendix, and she never came back.
Well, you just can't think that way, Catherine. Look at all this mail. Miss Wiley said people would be on our side, and she was right. Here's one from California.
What if we don't win?
Of course we'll win.
And what if we don't? My father will lose his house. We'll be on the street. You'll be on the street. You and Tom will never get married. How can you stand it, Grace?
Catherine, please.
How can Tom stand it? I never hear him complain.
Catherine, Once the judge hears our testimony, he's gonna rule for us. All they gotta do is take one look at us. It'll be over in a day.
You sure?
Of course. We'd be awful hard to ignore, don't you think?
Won't it be something then, huh? To see the look on Mr. Reader's face?
Now, wanna read some more letters?
They didn't have no vanilla, so I got some chocolate.
Took you long enough.
Don't get on me. I had six people stop me on the way over here. All of them reporters and all of them asking after you.
Waiting for me to die.
No one's waiting for you to die.
It's true. One of them called my mother, asking if I had died. And when she said no, he sounded disappointed.
Here, eat some of this. You'll feel better.
Evening, ladies. Have a picture.
For the love of Mike, what are you doing?
We need some pictures for graphic exclusive on the girl.
Exclusive? What are you talking about?
$5,000, that's what I'm sacred. The idea is $5,000.
I don't understand.
Perhaps you're familiar with Bernard McFadden.
Who, that faith healer?
Mr. Crater, Herbalist. Bernard McFadden handed herbal therapy. It's just the thing to get this girl back on her feet, and the graphic will pay for it. All we ask is the exclusive right to your story from here on out. See for yourself.
And you want to pay us to go see Bernard McFadden?
Easy money, huh?
Let me see that.
They're serious, Grace.
I don't know.
Grace, what is your father owe in the house?
I don't know exactly.
And that last hospital bill? A couple hundred at least.
At least.
Maybe we should think about this.
Maybe we should talk to Miss Wiley about it.
Miss Wiley? What's up to her? You're the one with bills to pay.
It wouldn't be right to do something like this without talking to Miss Wiley first.
Big girl, lady. Can't you make your own decision?
Of course I can make my own decisions.
You'd take it if it was from the company.
The company owes us a lot more than that.
If you ever see it.
Maybe we should think about it.
It just don't feel right.
You're gonna talk to the reporters anyhow. Why not get something out of it?
He's right now. Why give your story away when people are crazy to read it? Believe me, you go to Captain and Bay. The day we ran the theater on you, BAY! Sold out every copy of every newsstand. Everybody can sympathize with the plight of the poor sick girl with no hope in fulfillment of motherhood.
I'd like for you to go now. My friend needs her rest.
Grace, at least think about this.
Sure, I understand. You're worried about what other people think, but hey, there's no reason you shouldn't get something out of all this. Look out for number one, that's the way. Everyone else is out to get what they can, for sure. Well, so why should you keep your nose clean when everyone else is up to their elbows in it?
Ladies and gentlemen, I have chewed enough of the girls who think they got sick here. One of them, the girl's jaw rotted so bad, I removed it, just by lifting the bone out of her mouth, as you can see over here.
Oh, that's all right, Dr. Neff. You can put that away.
Maybe you'd rather look on the x-ray then. Look. So over here. Look, this is an expensive case to treat now. I never did get no compensation. The girl died, her family never paid.
I sympathize, Dr. Neff, but what does that have to do with us?
Here it is, Street. This got me all the girls coming out here and saying they got sick here. So I was thinking we could do business. I scratch your back, you scratch mine, that sort of thing.
I'm not following you.
Say you wish to give me a list of the girls who work here. I'd see to it there were no more lawsuits.
Do you think you could cure them?
I couldn't put out a cure, no. I'm saying I scratch your back, you scratch mine.
How so, Dr. Neff?
I'd examine them for radium necrosis, and I'd come up with a favorable diagnosis for you. Pyoria, say, or something else. What if your cases will just die a natural death anyway? And the rest we can put off for a while until the statute of limitations kicks in and it's too late to sue.
You'll persuade them. They haven't got a case against the company.
Exactly. And if it ever did come to court, I could testify that it was some other problem. And there would be strong testimony come from a dentist who treated them.
What makes you so sure these girls will come to you?
Well, come to me quick, if I'm charging nothing.
Because we'd be paying you.
Exactly right. We understand each other, Mr. Reader.
Exactly what are you asking for, Dr. Neff?
I need $10,000.
What?
$5,000 so far. And for every article out the greeter see from here, and now it's $2 for every visit, plus expenses for the x-rays. I was just in about Jellabot's agreement here, but the rocket's not writing.
No.
All right, we're in writing.
No, your proposal is immoral and will have nothing to do with it.
Immoral, you say? You're a fine one to be talking about morals.
Mr. Lee!
You got your own hired guns when you testified.
Those were expert witnesses.
Expert witnesses? Hey, Lapis is just more like it. And none of them's got the dirt I got. If you're smart, you'll play ball with them. Trust me, there's plenty of other folks in your sense of information.
You're threatening me.
Just a business proposition, Mr. Rieger. Just looking out for my own interests. Say, may you look out for yours.
Mr. Lee, see Dr. Neff to the door.
Oh, all right. You don't be wrong. Fine. Believe me, though, when all of this shakes out, well, it won't be me holding the shroud this day.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want you all to make statements on what happened here this morning. We'll send them to the State Dental Society. Then Dr. Neff will see who's playing ball and who isn't.
Yeah, I guess that would make sense.
An excellent idea.
I don't know. Perhaps we shouldn't be so quick to dismiss Dr. Neff's proposal?
What do you mean?
We're in a very bad situation here, Mr. Reeder.
That's true. Mr. Lee says you're having trouble getting girls to work here.
Yes, and we lost some contracts because of it.
And it's going to get worse.
The papers are full of stories about those girls.
Making them out to be saints.
And what defense can we put out?
Except to say we'll try our case in court.
In the court of public opinion? We've already lost.
Perhaps we should reconsider. Certainly wouldn't hurt if we had the testimony from the dentist that treated those girls.
Neff can be very helpful to us. We should retain her.
Retain her as what? An extortionist?
As an expert.
Like Dr. Flynn.
Dr. Flynn is a highly respected professor from Columbia University. Neff? Neff is a neighborhood dentist.
Well, Dr. Flynn treated those girls, didn't she?
She didn't treat them. She consulted with them.
She dispensed medical advice, Arthur.
It wasn't medical advice. It was an expert's opinion. A scientific opinion.
How about this? We retain Neff, but we don't put her on the stand. Just so we can keep her from testifying for the woman.
That's the most important thing.
Would you agree with something like that, Mr. Reeder?
Mr. Reeder?
Edward, we can't possibly do this. We can't get into a bed with a woman like Neff.
Arthur's right. We don't want to do business with Neff.
She could hurt us. We have to take steps.
Neff's given us everything we already need. New evidence, ladies and gentlemen. This is grounds for a postponement.
3 months. 3 months to study an x-ray. It's outrageous. And the girls. Did you see the girls? Their eyes are like saucers looking. Terrifying. How are they going to hold out 3 more months? Catherine Shaw could barely make it into the courtroom today. In grace, she was trying so hard not to cry. And of course, I had all the answers. Go home, girls. Get some rest. That's the best I can do. Get some rest.
You're doing wonderful, Miss Barry. It's a very difficult case.
I don't understand people like Marley. And Rick, how can you play that kind of game with a girl sitting right over there?
Maybe this will help explain. I received a letter.
I don't understand. I just don't understand.
Miss Berry. Well, I received this letter. It's from Dr. Kathleen Drinker. Miss Cecil Drinker? Of Harvard? She's an industrial hygienist also, and worked very closely with Dr. Drinker on his study of the radium plant. It was a joint effort, actually.
That's very interesting, Miss Wiley, but we've already seen that document. Nothing in it to help us.
You've only seen part of it, Miss Berry. Please. This is the full report. Apparently, Catherine Drinker has been following our story very closely in the papers and was particularly disturbed to read the last article in the ledger, the one where Mr. Lee claims her study cleared the company.
He doctored the report. Reader doctored the report.
Apparently, he left out an entire page listing the blood conditions of a dozen employees. Doesn't look so bad by itself, but in context, it's somewhat a different story.
We can use this.
Yes, it should have passed the judge.
The judge? Miss White, I'm not going to wait 3 months to make you something like this. I want you to call that contact you have with the New York Herald. If the reader won't let us present evidence in the courtroom, then he can read about it in the newspaper.
Bonnie is radioactive.
Bomb the dead girl, kick off gamma ray. Radium girls go to court today.
Radium Girl knocked at the doors of justice. Will they be heard?
These poor girls
face pain, ruin, disfigurement, and death as the clock ticks away at this precious moment.
Catherine Wiley from Consumer League declares new evidence shows company lied.
As the clock ticks away at this precious moment, a hearing begins in Chancery Court, where U.S. Radium Corporation demands a postponement, showing that the company lied to the Department of Labor, concealing its ill effects of the product. Read all about it in the graphic. We care because you care.
Adam?
We didn't read it?
I make a point not to these days.
I wish other people would do the same. Miss Mitchell, from across the street, walked right past me. Didn't say a word to me. I know she saw me. And at the market, the greengrocer put a stare. And at the club, whispers.
Why don't you put that away? Read the journal. I saw it here the other day. Why don't you read that?
At the club, one of the ladies had the nerve to say to me, is it true? Is it true what your husband did to those women? I said, Miss Cowles, if you really believe that, then why would you talk to me at all? I certainly wouldn't associate with a woman whose husband did such things.
Why do you go there then, if that's the way the people are?
I've been a member for years.
What do you want me to say, Diane? I knew we were poisoning people, but we didn't want to stop because we were making too much money. Is that what you want me to say?
Certainly don't want you to say such a thing.
Even if it were true, or especially if it were true.
Is it true?
Is that what you think?
What would you like me to think?
For God's sakes, Diane, don't you see what's going on? It's Von Cisciocchi. He's behind all this. He's been feeding information to the Consumers League so they can railroad us.
Why would the Consumers
League? Bunch of radical women. Half of them are do-gooders. Socialists. Same thing to that club you belong to.
What?
You women think you can go around and fix the world's problems?
I'm sorry, I can't.
While your husband's out and make a living, you're going to quit that club.
Quit the club?
And stop talking to that idiot, Miss Middleton. She doesn't know anything. None of you women know anything. You don't know anything.
Did you lie to the Department of Labor?
What?
Did you lie?
I didn't lie, I just didn't agree with Dreamer's results.
Arthur.
I have a fiduciary duty to the company.
I can't listen to this.
Diane, I have documents. I have articles. People with tumors the size of baseballs. Radium therapy, the tumors disappear. Diane.
I'm tired. I'm going upstairs.
Oh, we save lives. We make lives better. Mild radium therapy invigorates. You can't possibly think I'm a liar. Do you really think I'd go out to send and poison all those women?
No.
Do you ever think I'd do anything to hurt you or hurt Harriet?
Certainly not.
Then
13 girls have died.
People die every day. Young, old, infants. The newspapers are full of death notices.
But they worked for you.
They also worked other places. Diane, I report from Columbia University, an expert in industrial hygiene, just like Drinker, who says there is no connection between our plant and the illnesses. Did you want to see the report?
Then what would the cause be?
I don't know. I've done everything I could to find out. I just don't know. Nobody does.
Bernie.
Do you know what you said to me that day I told my father I wasn't going into the ministry?
You can do as much good in a boardroom as you can in a church.
You remember?
Think I'd forget?
I was such a scared kid, and he was an icon. If it wasn't for you, I don't think I could stand up for myself.
You would have done the right thing, Artie. I know you would have.
We saved lives.
You saved lives.
It's all for you. It always has been.
I know.
Arthur! Arthur! Arthur!
For God's sake, Charlie!
I actually got off the telephone with someone from the ledger.
Couldn't this wait until the morning?
Of course, I'm sorry. Good evening.
Mr. Lee?
It's Dr. Lemon.
Dan?
He's dead, Arthur.
What?
He died this morning.
That can't be possible. We just saw him last week.
They were just here for cards a month ago. They were just here.
Well, Marlon's already done the autopsy. She said it was severe anemia.
She's blaming the radium?
The ledger's gonna run it on page one. I told the reporter we would issue a statement at 8 o'clock. That's when he needs it, so it can run tomorrow.
When are the services?
Sorry?
The services!
Oh, I don't know.
We'll send flowers. Diane?
Of course. I'll call Louise.
Yes, that's right. Call Louise.
Oh, we should go visit her. Oh, poor Louise. We'll go visit her right now.
I wouldn't do that.
Why ever not?
She's, planning to sue.
Louise?
The reporter from the ledger told me. She's filing up a wrongful death action. I worked up a statement for the paper. Company chemist for 8 years. Always in poor health, recently in decline.
Dan was never sickly. He was always on the golf course, or sailing, or he kept a beautiful garden.
We'll take care of this in the morning, Charlie.
Of course. Sorry to bring you the bad news, Mrs. Reader. Good night.
Good night, Mr. Lee.
Charlie can be a bit excessive at times. I don't know what we'll say. We have to say something. The shareholders will expect it.
You needn't explain.
Sometimes it's necessary.
It's all right. You really needn't explain. We're gonna get rid of this now.
There are two cases under the sink.
We'll get rid of that too. I'll have no more of it in this house.
I'll do it. Diane, I meant too far to quit.
I really didn't expect you to. Dear Miss Fryer, I read of your woeful situation in the Atlantic Constitution, and I'm prepared to offer you a solution. Venison, a wonder tonic made from all natural ingredients. Venison will restore your health and vitality. We're prepared to offer you girls a lifetime supply of venison in exchange for the exclusive rights to use your pictures in our advertisements.
Body is radioactive.
Bones of dead girl, kick off gamma rays.
Catherine Wiley, Consumer League, declares new evidence shows company lied.
Dr. Josephine Neff, a Newark dentist who treated Amelia, has recently turned over portions of the jawbone that she removed from her and had found that they're radioactive 5 years after the girl died. Will this force a settlement?
Will this make your case, Miss Wiley?
Will this make our case? No. This woman will make our case. Last night, in a graphic exclusive, the founder of U.S. Radium Corporation broke his long silence with a shocking announcement.
Palladium is one of the most dangerous substances known to man.
Doctor, is it true you assisted with the autopsy?
Yeah, and given my expertise in ladium extraction, I was able to determine Miss Bagai absorbed enough ladium to kill 10 people.
And what is this saying for myoradium therapy? Are you now rising against it?
Palladium is responsible for the deaths of these girls. It should be considered as the most dangerous substance.
Do you agree with the doctor's prognosis that the radium girls only have a year to live?
From what I've seen, they'll be lucky to last that long.
I'll tell you what we should have done. We should have taken that reporter up on her offer when we had the chance. That's what we should have done.
$1,500? Don't make me laugh.
We should have talked her up too, because I tell you what, they'd have paid. And I'll tell you what else we should have done.
Stop telling me what we should have done. Lots of things we should have done. Don't do no good to think about them now.
All right, keep your shirt on.
What do you think, the red or the blue?
So, what's Barry say? Is she gonna go back to the company?
I like the red, but they don't fit so good these days.
Is she gonna try to talk the company up a bit?
Miss Wiley wants to do another interview, so I say what's one more, you know?
It's worth a try, don't you think? What if it came to 5,000? Would you take it then?
Let him come up. I'm not giving in.
It's called a settlement.
Settlement? It's just a way for them to hide.
Let them hide.
Then they win.
They're gonna win anyways.
Nice to know you got so much confidence in me.
For Christ's sakes, Grace. You got one lawyer working for nothing, up against 6 other lawyers that are getting a bundle, and you think you have a chance?
You know what I found out today? They put lead screens in the laboratories for the technicians. Did they give us lead screens?
Oh boy.
What do you think? 100 girls in a room, and they're not gonna spend that kind of money on us.
Grace.
And they want to keep it all quiet.
What are we doing here, Grace?
And Miss Wiley says they want to close down.
Grace.
And move across the river to open up another factory like nothing ever happened.
What are we doing here, Grace? I thought the idea was that we'd get some money to settle your debts, get a better doctor, and we'd get on with things.
Get on with things?
You're still wearing my ring.
Oh, Tommy.
Grace, there's a house for sale in my brother's neighborhood. 2 rooms up,
two rooms down. Not much, but it's a start. You'll like it. It's already got flowered wallpaper. And best of all, it's only two blocks from school.
The school? What do we need of this school?
Plan ahead for once.
Tommy, what do you think is going to happen after all this is over? Do you think everything will just go back to the way it was?
Why wouldn't it?
I gotta see the surgeon again.
Uh-huh.
I have some fluid. He's gonna drain it.
Okay.
And then he says there'll be more.
So we deal with it when it comes.
And still more, and more, and more. Why can't you see that? How can you talk about getting married and buying houses when you know there's nothing that I can...
I can't think about that, Grace. I just want for us to be together now. I want to come home to you at night. My wife, my home. I'm too old to be living this in-between life. I promise you, Grace, I'll do whatever it takes to make it easy for you.
Here.
Grace, come on.
I should have gave it back to you a long time ago.
I don't want it.
Tommy, please. Are you gonna make me say it?
You haven't been getting enough rest. You just need some sleep.
Oh, Tommy.
I'll come see you tomorrow.
Tommy! Tommy, please, don't you do this to me! Tommy!
Arthur?
Charlie.
Aren't you at home?
Charlie, I've been thinking though. I think we're taking the wrong approach here. I think we should settle this case. We've got to come up with a reasonable offer.
No, Arthur. We agree. We need a definitive victory. Otherwise, we'll just invite more of the same nonsense.
Things have changed.
Arthur, I knew you and Dan were close, but you can't let that cloud your judgment.
Von Krzyzewski is going to testify.
We can deal with it.
How?
Put more money in his pocket.
Now you want to bribe him?
No, not a bribe, my friend. Consideration.
Consideration?
For an expert witness. Whatever Miss Barry's paying him, we'll just make a better offer.
You really don't understand guilt, do you, Charlie?
Right now, I don't have the luxury of thinking about it.
Charlie, let me tell you something. A guilty man has a tremendous need to unburden himself. His guilt can eat him alive. That is why Von Schock is testifying for the girls. That much will never testify for us, no matter how much consideration you offer.
We'll settle with these girls, and you have to settle with all the others. Neff was right about that.
This is just the beginning. Tell Markley to get in touch with Barry. Come up with a figure those girls can accept.
Arthur, for God's sake, what are you trying to do to me? Do you want to wipe me out?
We've got to get this off the table.
Every penny I put by in the last 7 years, I have sunk into this company. Why? Because of you. Because you said it was a sure thing. No miss. Why would we run to Shocky when we can work for ourselves? Remember that one? Take a chance, Charlie. Take a chance.
Von Krzyzewski fooled us. He fooled us all. The best thing we can do now is to try to clean it up as best we can.
We'll do this, and it's the end, Arthur.
You're stepping down?
Not me.
Well,
don't you know? They are one vote away from getting rid of you.
And whose vote is that, Charlie?
Arthur, have you so little faith in me?
You don't have enough votes to get me off the board. I'm still a stockholder. You'll never get me off the board.
Well, and still on the hook if this company goes under. Think about that the next time your conscience starts to bother you.
March 15th, 1928. To Rachel Berry, attorney at law. From Edward Markley, counsel, U.S. Radium. One of our expert witnesses has encountered a serious scheduling conflict, which makes it impossible for her to testify in April. We have therefore requested an extension until June. As for your request for a settlement, every case involves some humanitarian aspect. Therefore, I am afraid that cannot be the basis for settling this one, but I have no doubt you will be rewarded for the good work you are doing. If not in this world, then in the next.
No, Tommy, please.
Rise and shine.
Madam Curie?
Time for work.
Oh, my lady, I set the alarm.
We have 5,000 tiles to paint before breakfast. Up. It's all for the war effort.
Please, I'm so very tired.
No complaining. Good soldiers don't complain.
But I'm dying.
And who is it? Get up, Grace.
Irene?
Come on, sleepyhead. You'll never make a photo like that.
It's
not fair. I'm only 26. I should be married by now. I should have my own home, my own children.
We all have to make sacrifices sometimes.
I know I did.
But why? Why do we have to make sacrifices?
It's all for science. Science, family, every life is sacrificed for something. Just a matter of choosing which.
I didn't have no choice.
Sure you did, Grace. Sure you did.
Catherine, don't do that. Catherine?
Now look what you did, Grace. She's bleeding all over the dial.
I'm sorry, Catherine. I just didn't consider it.
No problem. What's another dead dial danger?
Huh?
Grace.
Mama?
Grace, Mr. Markley will be here any minute.
Mr. Markley?
He's bringing my papers for you to sign. Did you fall asleep?
Has Miss Wiley been by?
Miss Wiley?
She said she'd stop by. About Catherine.
She might have.
Don't you know?
Someone came by the door a while ago. I think your brother answered it. Look, Grace, you gotta get ready.
They took Catherine back to the hospital last night.
I know, dear. I know. After you talk to Mr. Markley, we'll go down and see how she is. But for now, get ready.
I dreamt she died.
Don't speak such things.
If she dies, it's over.
We're 3 months behind on the mortgage, Grace.
I know that.
You can't let this go on.
$1,500? Not even a year's wages.
Better than nothing, ain't it?
Is that all I'm worth? Better than nothing?
Of course not, sweetheart, but we gotta be realistic. At the rate things are going, we'll never get in that courtroom. And even if you do, you can't prove anything.
Miss Barry thinks we can.
Miss Barry ain't paying the bills. We got the doctor, the bank, the coal man. You can't expect people to treat us like charity just because you're sick.
I'm not asking for charity, Ma. I just want what's owed to me.
I know it feels like you're letting Catherine down. But if she decided to take the bank's offer, you wouldn't hold it against her. No, you wouldn't. Now, we'll take that check, pay off our bills, and whatever's left, you'll come to have. A little something to get you started.
There's nothing to start, huh?
Why you gotta be so hard on Tommy?
Oh, please don't.
Can't you see? He just can't bear the thought of you not being with us.
I have to bear it. Why can't he?
There's something with your...
$250,000. What would you do with $250,000, Briar? Why? I can't imagine. No point to it.
Pam?
New Mexico, huh? They just keep coming.
She was here. Miss Wiley was here. Ma! Miss Wiley was here this morning. She left me a note.
Miss Fryer, Edward Markley.
Ma said you brought papers.
Yes, the terms filled out as they did in our letter. $1,500 to you. I got the check right here, and all we need is your signature. It's in triplicate.
Mr. Markley is a very busy man.
Oh no, please, take your time. Look it over carefully. If you prefer, I can come back tomorrow.
No, we'll do this now.
What's hold harmless?
You agreed to hold the company harmless from any further action.
No more lawsuits?
Correct.
Is that just me or anybody in my family?
Your entire family. It precludes a wrongful death action also.
This is a confidential settlement.
Yes.
You didn't say nothing about it being confidential.
That's standard for most legal settlements, Ms. Fryer. We like to protect our privacy, and your privacy also. Cuts both ways. You agree to keep silent about the terms of the policy, and so do we.
That seems fair.
Need a pen?
I have another question.
Grace, Mr. Markley has already explained the terms of the settlement to you.
Huh?
I don't mind.
What's contributory negligence? It's not in that. It was in the other papers. The one you filed for the lawsuit. The Radium Company said that their defense was a statute of limitations and contributory negligence.
I'm not sure what you're asking, Ms. Fryer.
It means it's our fault, doesn't it?
It's a standard defense, Ms. Fryer. I wouldn't take it personally.
How else can I take it?
Mr. Markley, Grace has had an awful headache all day. If you just give me them papers.
He could just answer my question.
Why are you doing this?
Why didn't you tell me Miss Wiley was here?
You already made up your mind. She just tried to change it.
What did she say about Catherine?
Miss Murphy, I'll take them papers and Grace's on later.
Mom, what did she say about Catherine?
She said it don't look good.
Perhaps I should come back tomorrow when Miss Fryer's feeling better.
You didn't answer my question, Mr. Markley, and I'd really like an answer, because let me tell you, I quit school at 15. I went to work at your company because my folks needed the money. At your factory, they told us what to do, when to do it, how to do it. My folks didn't raise me to trouble, so I did it. I did what I was told. I never asked questions. How do you get contributory negligence out of that?
As I said before, it's a standard defense.
There's nothing standard about what happened to me.
We deeply regret your situation, but there is no evidence to tie your conditions to the U.S. Radium Corporation.
Then why give me all this money?
It's a humanitarian gesture.
A humanitarian gesture?
Mr. Markley, I'll take them papers.
A humanitarian gesture? Month after month, you put us off. Delay after delay, knowing how sick we were, how tired we were. Humanitarian, you're just waiting for us to die.
Grace, stop this now.
Mom, one by one, I've watched my friends get sick and die in the most horrible way. And you think I should be grateful for whatever spare change they throw at me?
Miss Fryer, this is a very generous offer. Under the circumstances, I would advise you take it, because it won't be on the table very long.
What do you mean?
If Miss Fryer does not sign within 24 hours, we will be forced to withdraw our offer permanently.
Grace!
He's lying.
I beg your pardon, miss.
You're telling me that if I don't sign these papers now, but I come back a week from now saying I changed my mind, you'd still rather go to court? You'd still rather some judge have a look at me and not take your chances that I won't win on sympathy alone? 24 hours. You're just trying to bully me.
All right, Miss Fryer. I'll take that as a no. We'll see you in court.
Yes, you will see me. If they have to carry me in there, you'll see me. You and Mr. Reed are both.
You call that man back.
I'm going to court, Ma.
What are you trying to prove? You know you can't win.
I want those people to look at me. I want them to look at me and tell me how it's my fault I got sick working in their factory.
And what'll that get you? What?
Mom, all my life, I've done what other people told me to do. I quit school because you said I should. I put that brush in my mouth because Mrs. McNeil said I should. I never said, please, can I finish school? I never said, I don't like the taste of this paint. I never argued, even though I knew, Mom. I knew something wasn't right. At night, I'd lie in bed and I'd see my dress hanging at the back of the closet door, all aglow. My shoes on the floor, my hairbrush, my comb. So much light, Mom. So much light. And I never once questioned. I never once asked. Don't you see? They knew I wouldn't. That's what they were counting on.
Arthur, so it is you making all this noise.
I left messages with your housekeeper. I know you got those messages.
As we are no longer in business, I thought it would be best not to respond.
Is that what this is about?
Perhaps a cup of tea will calm your nerves.
You never told us the paint was dangerous. You never said a word about it. Not to me, not to Dan.
I didn't know.
You didn't know? You invented the paint, and you didn't know? How can you lie like that?
I didn't know until it was too late, Arthur.
I should put you through that wall.
Perhaps you should, but you won't. You will sit down, you will have some tea, and you will calm yourself.
I wasn't the technical man. You were the technical man.
Yeah, I was the technical man. Sit down, Arthur.
I sold watches, for Christ's sake. I was a salesman.
A really good salesman at that. Really good head for his business. Not so much for his science, but for his business, always you could cut costs without losing your quality. That's a gift, Arthur. So why don't you sit down and have some tea?
Jesus Christ, what's the matter with your hands?
It's been that way for some time.
I had no idea.
But I've known for a while now Miss Wiley from the Consumers League persuaded me to assist Dr. Marlin in the testing of the dialogue. There aren't that many people around, you know, who can test such a thing. So she came to me, knowing I had the equipment and, of course, the skill. I didn't believe her, Arthur. I didn't want to believe the girls could get sick working with my paint. I wanted to show her it was a mistake, so I agreed to help. And it was then when Dr. Marlin and I conducted an expired air test on the girls. When my own breath registered radioactive, then my fingers, they began to turn black. Now you wish to have words with me?
I
I'm sorry.
Perhaps now you should make an appointment with Dr. Marlin yourself.
Me? What for?
Arthur, you didn't notice the glowing dust on your shoes when you went home at night?
How kind is it? I tracked them all over the house.
You can be pretty sure a good deal of it is now in your lungs. You look familiar?
It's our promotional piece.
An excellent promotion piece. How many new sales does that book account for?
I didn't track it exactly. I think it helped our medical market quite a bit.
Page 96.
What?
Open it. It's the last chapter. Leave it to me.
Last chapter? Radium dangerous effects?
Dangerous effects. How many articles do you have listed there? 10, 15?
About 18, it looks like.
How far back do you say those articles?
I don't know.
Look at it. It's the first one there. What is the date?
1906.
1906. Now let me see. When you go into court, you plan to testify that you had no idea that the radium was dangerous. How do you plan to do that, Arthur? When your own book says that it was dangerous. How can you say you did not know?
I never really read it.
What's that?
I never really read it. I hired an outside man to put it together. I never read it. I just glanced at the galleys. I never read the book. Standard arrangement, an outside company prepared the piece. They were responsible for its content.
Which you never read.
I think you will find, Miss Barry, that very few company presidents read their own promotions, or word for word.
It has your name on it. You authorize the book, please. And you had final approval of the content.
Mr. Lee was responsible for its content. I entrusted those activities to him.
Now, Mr. Lee, you testified that you started in U.S. Radium Corporation in 1918.
Yes, plant manager.
And you held this position for how long?
4 years.
And during those 4 years, how often did you venture into the studio?
Every day.
Every day. So you must have observed the girls pointing their brushes to their lips.
I don't recall.
You're saying you went into the studio every day and you never saw a single girl put a brush to her mouth.
I said I don't recall it.
You don't recall. What do you recall, Mr. Reader? You're an awfully young man to have such a false memory.
Objection!
I withdraw. No more questions.
Your witness, Mr. Harvey?
We have no questions for this witness, Your Honor.
All right, counsel. Please approach. Raise your issue, Member Lee.
Our witnesses are prepared to testify that the company had no idea that the lady was dangerous.
I understand, Mr. Murphy, but this proceeding is literally standing. Now, I've heard about these past 2 days to make a determination. The radium and imposing these girls on due source of poison. Nothing your witnesses can say will change that fact, will it?
Yes, Your Honor.
Ms. Murphy, in the interest of justice, I'm afraid your witnesses can testify. I ask the defense rest without calling any witnesses.
All right, Your Honor.
He's here today.
I'm going
to case
of
trial.
Your Honor, one thing. I have a very full schedule with 2 other cases pending, and our chief expert witness cannot be available until the end of the summer. We cannot be available until September.
Your Honor!
I'm sorry, Your Honor, but our chief expert witness is associated in the Institution of Higher Learning, and it is the busiest time of year for him, and I cannot expect him to appear.
Mr. Markley is responsible for that situation. He's the one that has demanded continuous delays.
I'm sorry, Your Honor, but we just agreed to waive our right to present witnesses at this hearing. Surely you cannot expect us to testify without their presence.
All right, Mr. Murphy. First things first. I'm ready to issue my ruling. The radium, first of all, statute of limitations has not been exhausted, and these girls have sang a suit. Now, on the matter of your distraction, well, the hearing is, well, we signed until December. This hearing is adjourned.
He's going to Europe.
Europe? But she's known about him for months. How could she? Oh, very clever, Edward. How long have you been with this thought?
As long as necessary.
Mr. Barclay?
Miss Barry, congratulations. I never thought the court would go for it.
You know full well these girls can't wait until September. What is so ill she can't appear in court?
My witness has the right to make his defense.
You're responsible for that situation. We will not wait until September. I promise you that. One way or another, we will find room on the docket and your expert witness be damned.
The girl, she's just
staring at me.
I won't worry about it.
But she thinks that I planned this. How do I make her understand that I didn't want any of this to happen?
You don't. You don't make her understand. You don't talk to her.
But she looks like death, Edward. They all look like death, Arthur.
Grace? I don't feel this way. He won't look at me. He won't ever look at me. He just looks right past me. Like I'm not even there.
It's all right, Grace. He heard you.
June 4th, 1928.
Jack.
Nancy Jane Harmon here for the New York Ledger. Stop it.
Jackie, you're for the New York Ledger.
Rachel, plaintiff Rachel Berry announces trial date for early summer.
As New York Radium Corporation announces a settlement.
A settlement?
$100 cash for each girl and $12 a week for life.
$12 a week?
Read all about on the ledger. Your first source for news.
The company also agrees to pay the medical expenses of each girl for the remainder of her life. And the girls have agreed to submit periodic examinations brought by a panel of physicians yet to be appointed. Questions?
What led to the settlement?
Is it admission responsibility?
It was purely for humanitarian reasons that the U.S. Radium Corporation agreed to the settlement. We admit no liability whatsoever.
Where did the company go from here?
Well, I'm proud to say that the U.S. Radium Corporation is pleased to have brought this lengthy litigation to a close and looks forward for many years serving its customers and its community. And that's C.B. Lee, President.
Catherine Wiley of the Consumers League, our press statement. Were you pleased with the outcome, Ms. Wiley?
Finally, these girls got the compensation they deserve for their suffering. And more importantly, the issue of radium poisoning has been brought to public awareness.
Thanks, Wiley.
And the spelling of that, by the way, is Wiley with one L and Catherine with a K.
Well, Edward, looks like we're back to business.
What's your name for?
Didn't I tell you? I got a buyer from the tailors that I'm tying up behind a building on Alton Street.
Oh.
Some contractor in Montclair needs a little infill.
That's perfect.
Now, Catherine, this one too, we can't see your name. There, that's better. Well, brought my watercolors today. Such a beautiful day. Too warm for a sweater. Not much of a breeze. Such a fine day to paint.
Thought I might find you up here.
You were right.
It's quiet up here.
Yep.
Well, if you wanted the rest in peace, this is the place to do it, huh?
I guess so.
What do you call that?
Watercolors. I'm a bit weak when it comes to landscapes, though.
No, it's nice, Grace. It's good.
First thing I bought with settlement money was some paints.
Big spender.
Then I bought a car.
I didn't know you could drive.
I can't. My brother drove me up here. He's gonna teach me.
Grace, if you want to learn how to drive, I teach you.
You got other things to do now, Tommy.
You know about that?
Tommy, Warren just isn't that big.
I was gonna tell you myself. That's why I came looking for you.
It's all right. I'm happy for you. For the both of you.
No hard feelings then?
Tommy, I got tired for that.
I'm glad it worked out for you, Grace. Are you glad? I mean, you don't think you backed down too soon, do you?
We didn't back down. They did.
Papa?
It was over here.
Oh, not this again.
This is where I saw her that last time.
This is morbid, Papa.
I stood there for a long time. She didn't notice me at first, but then something made her look up.
Oh, my. No wonder Mama won't come for drafts you anymore, if this is how you spend your Sundays.
She was looking at me, and I looked away.
Just like at the courthouse that day. He can't bring himself to look at me.
You need to find another hobby. Retirement isn't good for you.
My heart started pounding, Harry, and I don't know what I would say to her if I had the chance, and there I was, and I had the chance.
It's as if he's afraid to look at me.
I couldn't bring myself to speak.
He's afraid of me.
I had my chance and I couldn't speak.
So what did you say?
I think back on those days and I tried to think, how could this have happened? I remember so clearly climbing the stairs to the studio at Olive Street. And at the top of those stairs, those wide, high windows and the slant of the light, the way it hit the floor, the way the floor creaked under my feet, the smell of the place, chalky, like an old schoolroom. And those girls, schoolgirls really, all pent at the task in their plain blue overalls, their delicate little hands moving so quickly. No man could do the work those girls did. So delicate, so fast. I remember the brushes flying from the dials to the paint to the dials to their lips. Try as I might, Harriet. Try as I might. I cannot remember their faces. I never saw their faces.
Saving for